Today, we're going to be talking about rock-forming minerals and discussing the ways in which we can distinguish these minerals and discussing their relative abundances in Earth crust. So, let's get started. Rock-forming minerals. So, to give this picture a little bit more information behind it, I included it because, first of all, how freaking awesome is fluorescent rocks? While these aren't minerals per se, they are rocks that have minerals in them that allow them to freaking glow, okay? So it's awesome. So let's talk about some of the minerals that go into forming rocks and how awesome they are. So before we get to minerals, of course, we have to start with atoms. Okay, this may seem like really simple information, but it's worth reviewing. So atoms, they have protons, neutrons, and electrons. Here in this picture, you can see there are protons and neutrons in the center, or what we call the nucleus. And then there are electrons that, I wouldn't say orbit, but there are electrons that surround the nucleus in clouds or shells or orbitals. But that doesn't matter for us right now. All we need to know is that they are tiny. Their mass is negligible. The thing that gives the atom its mass is the protons and neutrons, and that isotopes are atoms that have the same number of protons but different number of neutrons. For example, carbon has carbon 12, carbon 13, and carbon 14. Carbon 12 has 6 protons and 6 neutrons, whereas carbon 13 has 6 protons but 7 neutrons, and carbon 14 has 6 protons but 8 neutrons. And so it's simple math. But basically, this is just to emphasize that it's a change in the number of neutrons. Therefore, it changes the mass of the atom significantly, especially if it's a small, you know, atom like carbon. If it's something like lead, obviously one neutron might not change that much, but it's significant most of the time, and that's why isotopes are really important in geology, and we'll get to that in further episodes. But I just want to distinguish that for now because it's important to distinguish isotopes from ions, which I also wrote here, and that's just a change in the electrons. So solids can either be crystalline or amorphous. This just means that the atoms within the solid can either be arranged in an orderly pattern or randomly. Minerals can either have a crystalline structure, like crystalline quartz, if you've ever seen those prisms of quartz, that's crystalline, whereas obsidian or glass breaks conchoidally, meaning it breaks randomly, and it's because its atoms are randomly arranged. They're not arranged in an orderly pattern, so there are amorphous solids, and minerals typically are crystalline but can be amorphous. Three main properties we'll talk about today in terms of minerals are hardness, density, and cleavage. Now, hardness is mainly determined by the strength of the bonds within the crystal structure. This means that something with a 3D crystal structure, like diamond, will be super hard, whereas something with a more 2D sheet-like structure, like graphite, even though it's still carbon, is going to be a lot softer or easier to break or scratch, basically. Density is determined mainly by atomic mass. So you can see here, I put an example of galena, which is a mineral made mostly of lead. And you know, lead is pretty heavy. And so you might see a piece of this and think that it's going to feel a certain way and then be really surprised when you hold it because it's way heavier than it looks. Lastly, cleavage or cleavage planes. So this is the way that minerals fracture, or the planes along which they fracture. This is determined by the crystal structure or mineral lattice. And the example I list here is halite, which has a cubic crystal structure. As you can see down at the bottom right, that's an example of how the atoms are arranged in halite. And halite is just salt, by the way, in ACL. And their atoms are arranged in a cubic structure, just as seen here. This is why it breaks in a cube way. So it'll always break along these planes because bonds are weakest at the boundaries of mineral lattices. All minerals that have a crystalline structure will break along their cleavage planes just like this. So moving on to the relative abundances of minerals in our crust. So Earth's crust is made up of over 90% silicate minerals. And you can see that everything in this pie chart except the tiny little slice of pie at the top that says non-silicates are silicate minerals. Clearly silicates are important, but what the heck does that mean? What are silicates? I will get to that in a second. I list here some types of minerals, or mineral groups as we call them, that aren't silicates, such as carbonates, sulfates, phosphates, halides, oxides, sulfides, and native elements. And we'll talk about those right after we talk about silicates. Silicate minerals are minerals that contain silica. What's silica? Silica is SiO4, literally a silicon atom. with four oxygens bonded to it. This is what all silicate minerals contain. So you can see here quartz is basically all silica. Feldspar is some other elements, but then contains silica. Hornblende contains silica. And these minerals, if you haven't heard of them, we're going to get into these in later episodes, but just know these are very abundant in Earth's crust, and they all contain silica and therefore are silicate minerals. Moving on to non-silicate mineral groups. Like I said, carbonates are one. I list calcite and dolomite. Calcite is calcium carbonate. It contains a carbonate ion, which is what deems it a carbonate. Dolomite also contains the carbonate, but it has magnesium as well, which is why it's different than calcite. You see here in the upper right corner a picture of calcite. Calcite has clear cleavage planes. It definitely breaks in an orderly way. That's an important distinction because calcite is really famous for its cleavage plane. Moving on to sulfates, you have gypsum and anhydrite. Gypsum is calcium sulfate with two H2Os, so that just means it's hydrated, whereas anhydrite has no water in its structure. Gypsum is pictured here to the right as well. Gypsum is an evaporite mineral, but we'll get into that in our sedimentary rocks lecture. Phosphates, I list apatite, which is an important mineral that you can find in your teeth and bones. It has a phosphate group, which is what makes it a phosphate mineral. Halides have a halogen, so chlorine, fluorine, so on. These are in the halogen column on the periodic table, and they form halite and fluorite, commonly known as salts. Moving on to oxides, which contain oxygen. Sulfides contain sulfide. So these are actually both iron minerals, both the oxide and the sulfide minerals. So we have hematite and pyrite. The difference between these iron minerals is that iron is oxidized in the oxide and pyrite is reduced iron. And this just is a difference in its electrons, but we'll talk about redox states in a different episode. And you can see a picture of pyrite to the right here. It looks really pretty and gold colored, and that's why it's also known as fool's gold. In terms of native elements, gold and diamond are the ones I have listed here. So obviously diamond is just carbon and gold is just gold. And that's why they're just called native elements, because they're just one element. Thank you all for watching. I hope that this episode taught you something about minerals, and I hope that it is a good primer for the upcoming episodes about rocks and the different rock types and what minerals go into helping us distinguish between these rock types. Can't wait to see you there!